ya dibujaba, ya hacía música, era creativo, era inquieto. Y eso es una constante en mi vida, que lo tengo como algo natural, no como algo, como un método aprendido, sino como algo natural. El flamenco para mí es fundamental, lo utilizo cuando pinto, oigo mucho flamenco, vengo de un sitio donde el flamenco es natural y es muy puro.
First, I will say thank you very much for the institution, for the Keynote invitation. It's a big honor to me to take part. I introduce myself in English. Normally, I do my workshop in English or German. But, I am living in the middle of Europe and here almost in a different language. However, today I will speak about me. And I don't like so much to speak about me myself. For this reason, I will speak in my mother language, in Spanish. And that I will translate to everybody. So, mi nombre es Emilio Fornieles, soy artista plástico, multidisciplinar y autodidacta. Como alguien realmente importante dijo en mis inicios, autodidacta que no se avergüenza de serlo. Vivo en Berlín desde hace 2 años y en ese tiempo, además de aprender inglés, aprender alemán, y haber conocido a la persona con la que comparto mi vida, que es la principal razón por la que estoy todavía en Berlín, he realizado multitud de exposiciones y eventos, siendo esta última exposición en Praga la más reciente, con el patrocinio de Le Palais, hotel en la Embajada Española y el Instituto Cervantes en Praga. El título de... bueno, pero eso...
My name is Emilio Fornieles. I'm a multidisciplinary artist, and I'm a self-taught artist. And someone very important said in my beginning, self-taught and shameless. I've been living in Berlin for 2 years, and in that time, apart from learning English and German and finding the love of my life, the main reason why I'm here in Berlin, I've conducted many exhibitions and events. This last exhibition was in Prague, and it was sponsored by Le Palais Art Hotel, the Spanish Embassy, and Instituto Cervantes.
Voy a hacer una breve introducción de mi concepto como autodidacta sobre el arte. El arte para mí es un lenguaje subjetivo. Es un lenguaje en el que el propio artista debe disfrutar con gusto y admiración de ese proceso creativo. Como decía Naguib Mahfouz, el Nobel egipcio de literatura, el gusto y admiración, ¿no? Definir o encasillar un estilo en una corriente, en un movimiento, a veces es un tanto arriesgado. Sobre todo para el artista, quizás para en los mercados del arte eso es algo necesario, pero sin embargo, cuando el artista todavía vive y el artista todavía desarrolla su obra, eso es un límite a la libertad creativa del propio artista, aún más cuando se está intentando de identificar su carácter, su personalidad artística, en este caso.
I'm going to give you an introduction of what I think art is as a self-taught artist. So for me, art is a subjective language. Art is supposed to develop joy and admiration and its creative process. And so for me, defining or labeling a style or specific movement is quite risky. I know that that's something art markets need, but for the artist, it can be quite limiting, because when you're an artist and you're creating your artwork, you're still growing as an artist, being labeled as something can be quite limiting. It limits the freedom of creativity.
Cuando el trabajo del artista refleja su propia personalidad, eso le hace diferenciarse del resto de otros lenguajes similares que desarrollan otros artistas. Su proceso formativo debe tomar referencia, debe beber de referencia, pero también debe saber alejarse de esa referencia y buscar su propia identidad, su propio lenguaje subjetivo y desarrollarlo, ¿no? La misión del artista es la de transmitir, básicamente, generar un lenguaje personal, una comunicación entre obra, el lenguaje subjetivo, que es la propia obra, y el receptor, en este caso, que es el público.
When an artist is able to reflect its personality, its character in its work, that's what makes his artwork different than others. An artist has to learn from others, but also to learn to put some distance between all the artist's work. He also has to make his own language, his subjective language, which is actually the base of artwork. And the mission of the artist is to transmit with his personal language, to be able to communicate with the audience.
El título de este discurso que voy a realizar guarda relación con un tipo de performance que yo realizo, y por eso toda la introducción que he puesto hasta ahora. Voy a hablar de una persona que en mis inicios fue muy importante, porque apadrinó mi primera exposición. Y después también me escribió un prólogo muy importante, un premio Nobel, José Saramago. Después definió mi estilo como expresionismo figurativo. Y claro, eso es un poco contradicción de lo que he expuesto anteriormente acerca de los ismos, acerca de los movimientos y acerca de encasillar o no. Pero también me hace sentirme realmente orgulloso porque con solamente dos palabras, expresionismo, figurativo, recogió sabiamente el sentido del progreso de mi obra, de mi técnica, como autodidacta, sin ni siquiera ver el progreso de la obra, del trabajo, solamente con el resultado. Y para mí eso son palabras que definen con precisión el resultado de mi técnica. A modo de análisis, muy breve, me gustaría proyectar una secuencia más acerca de eso, de lo que hablo, ¿no? Acerca de ese expresionismo, de esa figuración, donde confluyen dos conceptos en la técnica contrapuestos. Me refiero al caos y al orden, me refiero a la actuación y a la figuración. Parto de un caos abstracto para llegar a un orden figurativo. Si no me prolongo para que pueda traducir algo.
I would like to talk about a very important person, which in my beginning talked about myself. He was a very important in my beginnings. He was a professor of the Bible. He defined my style as figurative expression. He made me feel very proud because he was able to define my work just through work, and it was very accurate. It is still a contradiction about what I am saying. I feel that these two words define very good, very well in my art. So I would like also to walk through my art with this the next video. And in the next video we will see how in my paintings chaos and order meet, but also abstraction and figuration. This is my style simultaneously. It's a building process that starts in chaos, in absolute chaos, and finishes in a figurative order.
Expresionismo, reflejado en esa agresividad plástica de los trazos, imprecisión, quizás, ¿por qué no?, donde el error es estético, el error es parte del progreso que yo trabajo. No excluyo el error, lo considero parte de la naturaleza de la obra, del progreso de nacimiento de la obra. Y por ello lo hago de una forma libre, de gestos, formas y tonos. Sin dibujo preliminar, sin esbozo, ausente el dibujo en el progreso creativo. Parto directamente de la pintura. Eso me hace acercarme de forma libre al expresionismo, a la abstracción en realidad. Todos sabemos, conocemos dos formas básicas de representación plástica, que son la abstracción y la figuración, básicamente, ¿no? En mi estilo reconozco ambas, se dan ambas al tiempo. Un progreso constructivo a partir de un caos de forma y de tono que al final resultan un orden figurativo.
Expressionism is reflected in plastic aggressivity, in the speed of the stroke, in inaccuracy. I believe that inaccuracy, error, is part of the building and constructing progress. Because constructed chaos feeds with freedom of acts, shapes, and shades. We know two basic forms of artist expression, which is abstraction and figuration. I believe I recognize both in my art. I start in building something that comes from chaos and ends in an order of action, shapes, and shades.
Esta técnica personal la pongo de manifiesto en esos ejercicios personales que realizo de pintura rápida, en espectáculos en directo, a veces combinado, la mayoría de las veces combinado con otras artes escénicas, como hemos visto, sea con músicos de rock, sea con DJs, con música techno, con flamenco. Yo lo denomino action painting, porque es más que una prueba contra reloj. En 60 minutos me propongo acabar un retrato o un semi-retrato. Un semi-retrato de gran formato, de 2 metros por 1 vertical. A veces pintado en 60 minutos, otras veces pintado en menos, otras veces pintados al revés, porque la técnica, el progreso constructivo no guarda, no refleja que se tenga que hacer de una forma concreta. El proceso es caótico y el orden va a ser figurativo, da igual si al derecho o al revés.
My technique, I put it into practice through personal exercises of speed painting. Most of the time it's the live performances, and most of the time I share the stage with other artists, usually they're rock bands or DJs, electronic music, techno music, or traditional flamenco, as you saw before. This is what I call action painting. It is a race against the clock in which I try to finish in an hour or even less, a portrait or a semi-portrait of a large form of portrait, which is of 2 meters by 1.
For example,
sometimes I do this even backwards. I paint the painting backwards because I believe that the creative process is something that changes. It is composed and it ends with order, so it doesn't matter when.
Para ejemplo de lo que transmito, me gustaría mostrarles un vídeo de las recientes performances en este sentido que he realizado en Berlín y Praga, que son pinturas de gran formato, como digo, semi-retrato. ¿Por qué semi-retrato? Porque busco interactividad con el público, para que normalmente son personajes conocidos, rostros conocidos, por eso juego con esa interactividad, esa comunicación entre la obra y el público. Realizados en 60 minutos y muchas veces, como digo, pintados al revés. Vamos a ver el vídeo. Primero.
So as an example, I would like to show you a video with my most recent live performances that I made in Berlin and in Prague. These are large format paintings that they are portraits or half portraits in which I try to connect with the audience, which I usually paint no faces.
¿Quién escribirá canciones mi sacerdote por ti rezará. ¿Quién te escribirá canciones de amor? Mi sacerdote te pondrá flores, se arrodillará frente al cristal y hasta gastará besando tu ventana y soltará la hierba. ¿Quién te escribirá canciones de amor? ¿Quién disparará armadura se convierta de encaje? ¿Quién te escribirá canciones de amor? La simple vida de los héroes, la raíz torcida, vida de los santos, siempre confundiendo el calendario.
Mi estilo guarda una relación directa con las palabras. Si me preguntan por referencia, como autodidacta, siempre aludo a escritores mucho más que a pintores. No tengo referencias muchas de pintores. Sin embargo, sí hay una fuerte presencia de la literatura en la temática de lo que desarrollo, así como en el proceso técnico. En la temática hay series que he realizado, como la serie Angelitos Negros, donde hago un enaltecimiento de la capacidad del ser humano desde la infancia para sobrevivir en circunstancias adversas, ¿no? Como de referencia a un escritor, William Golding, en El Señor de las Moscas, esa capacidad del ser humano para, incluso en la infancia, de jerarquizarse y establecer una sociedad, lo intenté reflejar en aquella serie. La veremos, proyectaré imágenes al final. O la serie que hice de Apología a la Cultura, Pintores con Letra Grande, donde retrataba a escritores y pintores universales.
Sometimes images speak louder than words. I believe my style is closely related to words. When sometimes people ask me, where does my inspiration come from? I always mention more writers than painters. I I'm very influenced by literature, and it's very present in my work. Not only in the topics, such as, for example, the one of my series called Black Little Angels, where I try to speak about the power of the human being, even in childhood, to survive in difficult circumstances. And this was inspired by William Golding's book, Lord of the Flies, where even children were able to establish a hierarchy in this island. Or, for example, in another series that is called Painters with Capital P, where I painted the most known painters in literature.
Además de esa relación en cuanto a la elección de temas, también el progreso creativo, veo la fuerza del lenguaje, de las palabras. Solo que lo que transmito muchas veces a mis alumnos cuando realizo workshops, independientemente de las edades que tengan, trabajo con diversas edades, desde niños a personas mayores, lo que intento transmitirles es el sistema, ese lenguaje, pero no con palabras o frases, sino un lenguaje de lectura, de tono, de formas abstractas y escritura de esas formas y tonos abstractos adquiridos o leídos, ¿no? Eso es básicamente mi técnica, me baso en escribir tonos y formas. Conozco tres formas básicas de figuración para llegar a la figuración, ¿no? Desde mi punto de vista del natural, como lo hacían los clásicos, los antiguos, pintar como segunda opción de la imaginación, de la fantasía, de los sueños, lo onírico, o la tercera opción, que es la fotografía, que en definitiva es otro tipo de arte y es desde el que yo parto para pintar. Uso la fotografía para hacer una lectura y después, posterior, una escritura, aunque suene en términos literarios, pero básicamente es eso lo que desarrollo.
Apart from the relation between the choice of topics and this literary inspiration, I'm also able to recognize the power of words in my work. What I try to do to teach my students in workshops, that I make workshops with people of very different ages, is to be able to read, but not words or phrases, but read shapes and shades. So this is my technique. And I know only three forms of figuration. The first one is that of the nature, so like the one they use in the classical era. The second is that of the imagination, dreams and fantasy. And the third is photography, which is a very different type of art. And this is the type of art I use to get inspired. I get inspiration from a photography that I use to read, and then I use it to write.
Claro, luego aparecerían muchas formas de interpretar esa fotografía. Muchos estilos, otra vez, volver a los estilos. Pero a diferencia de pretender llegar a un hiperrealismo o a una figuración extrema, intento plasmar lo que he leído. Leo, interpreto y escribo. Ese es el proceso de mi técnica. Vuelvo otra vez a lo mismo. Al inicio hago referencia otra vez a Nagib Mahfouz, gusto, diversión y admiración. Bueno, no quisiera extenderme tampoco mucho más, pero te dejo que traduzcas antes de que siga con el siguiente punto.
So there are different styles to interpret this type of photography. This is what I do. I use photography to read it, to interpret it, and then to write it. This is my process. And I come back to quoting Nagib Mahfouz, Nobel Prize literature. So we have to do it with joy, with fun and admiration.
He hecho un análisis breve y un recorrido por la técnica, las performances o la pintura en directo, pintura rápida en directo. Pero también, bueno, eso es a nivel personal, cómo aplico. Tengo mi serie, desarrollo mi serie, no solamente pintura rápida. Lo aplico a ese tipo de shows, de espectáculos. Pero también tiene aplicaciones didácticas, también tiene aplicaciones en escuelas, en universidades, donde he podido, he tenido la oportunidad de hacerlo. ¿Quiere entrar?
I wouldn't like to keep talking too much, because I have to limit myself to the time I've been given. So we've gone through my technique, my styles, my live performances, or my paintings, but I would also like to show you how this applies on an education level. I've worked in schools and universities with different students from different ages. So I would like to talk about this.
Bueno, es un acercamiento. El tema de los workshops que yo propongo con esta técnica es un acercamiento a personas que por circunstancias se alejan de la actividad artística por un miedo al error, por un miedo a yo no sé dibujar, yo no sé pintar, y me veo ante ese límite. Lo practico con personas que generalmente nunca han trabajado con pintura, nunca han dibujado, con niños también, sobre todo, ¿no? Porque esa creencia de la incapacidad para labores plásticas todavía es más determinante y más dramática en críos, en niños, en personas jóvenes, porque los hay con un potencial creativo y desconoce que lo tienen. Hay niños con habilidades que se manifiestan rápidamente, pero hay otras personas que por ese miedo muchas veces al dibujo tienen creatividad y se ven distantes de la actividad creativa. Bueno, no soy académico, como ya he dicho, no pretendo tampoco hacer demagogia del arte porque no soy académico. Con estos talleres lo que busco es simplemente eso, un acercamiento con la excusa del arte, con la excusa de la pintura como pretexto, acercamiento entre diferentes edades, entre diferentes culturas y buscar esa, incluso diferentes ideologías, se me ha dado el caso, buscar esa interactividad, esa conexión multicultural, ¿no? A continuación vais a ver varios vídeos de mis talleres. El primero corresponde a niños de un colegio en Portugal, trabajando ese proceso de lectura y escritura. El resultado fue un retrato de grandes dimensiones, un políptico de 17 piezas, José Saramago. Y el segundo será un vídeo realizado con adultos de diferentes edades en la casa natal del Nobel Juan Ramón Jiménez, en Huelva. Si quieres, pues entra.
In these workshops, I work with different people of different ages, different ideologies even, and sometimes these people say, I don't know how to paint, I don't know how to draw, because they have never painted before. But what I try to do is to establish a relationship, and because some of these children, some are children, and some of these children have potential, but they don't know it yet. Some others do have abilities that show instantly, but some of us just are afraid of painting or drawing because they believe they're going to fail. They're afraid of failure. So in these workshops, I use art as an excuse to work with different people, different ideologies even. Now I'm going to show you two videos. The first one is a workshop in a school in Portugal where we worked in a portrait of José Saramago, and it's a 17 pieces portrait. The second video is also a different workshop that I did with people from very different ages. We did this in the house where Juan Ramón Jiménez, another Nobel Prize laureate, lived. So he did a portrait as well there in Huelva.
Un inciso antes de poner el vídeo. Ellos no saben el resultado de lo que van a pintar. Ellos manejan los fragmentos como pinturas abstractas, como un ejercicio, un juego de abstracción, de formas y de tono, simplemente. Y al final se sorprenden cuando ven que el resultado es figurativo. Puedes traducir eso, sí.
So in these workshops, these children or these people don't know what the result is going to be. They just work with a piece of it, and they don't know what the result is going to be. So they are always surprised when they see the result, that they parted from a chaos and they got to this figurative order.
The audio. No audio. Yeah, it's there. The problem is there in the end. Well, no problem. We can see the picture. Son 17 piezas. Y ahora, el siguiente vídeo. No sé si así habrá audio. No word. Sorry, don't worry. There are problems with the video. So, I don't have. Well, maybe I have here my computer because I thought before that could happen. Is here. Bueno, es decir que los ejercicios de este tipo de workshops están realizados en un tiempo de unas dos a tres horas, con una previa explicación de esa lectura de tono, de esa lectura de forma, esa forma de captar las escalas de gris en estos casos, para después transcribirlas, ¿no? Y ahora sí, no sé ya el tiempo que llevo. Para finalizar, y no sé si tendréis algo que preguntarme, me gustaría mostrarles un último vídeo que de forma breve repasa las series que componen mi obra. Me gustaría enseñar todo, lógicamente, como cualquier artista, pero no tengo tiempo para ello, un tiempo limitado. Por ello me limito a mostrar algunas piezas a modo de detalle de lo que se aprecia, en lo que podemos apreciar el concepto de la técnica y mi propio estilo de una forma detallada, ¿no? En resumen, secuencia que muestra los detalles de las obras, series realizadas desde 2007 hasta la actualidad, sin contar, por supuesto, obra puntual o algún tipo de otra actividad. Si quieres, pues traducir.
These workshops are usually from 2 to 3 hours, and before we start painting, I try to explain the students on how to read a painting, how to read a picture and then interpret it and then be able to write it, to be able to read these great skills in this case. And now I would like to showcase my artwork through the next video. Obviously, as an artist, I would love to show all my artworks, but time is of the essence and I will only show you some pieces that I've worked on from since 2007 until now.
Son angelitos negros, Black Little Angels. Bien, y ahora sí, agradecer a todos los presentes la atención y espero que hayan disfrutado con lo humilde de mis conocimientos. No quisiera despedirme sin antes agradecer nuevamente al Instituto de Diplomacia Cultural y no solamente la invitación, sino también el fomento de la multiculturalidad y el acercamiento entre las relaciones humanas, ¿no? Nada más, muchas gracias.
Finally, I would like to thank you for your attention and also thank the ICT, not only for my invitation, but to promote and encourage multiculturality and the approach to human relations. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias a ti también. Si alguien tiene algún tipo one question, I can try in English.
In English or Spanish?
We will try.
We will try. Okay. I love the work. It's
Thank
really
you.
Impressive. Thanks Thank a lot for sharing that. I have a few questions in one.
Okay.
The first one is, I mean, it's painting, but it's also part spectacle, part performance. So that's very
yeah.
interesting.
Yeah.
The second one is the role of time in what you're doing, because I mean, you sort of managed to produce out of chaos these almost photographic mm-hmm. images. And I'm wondering if if you give yourself that temporal limit in order to bring yourself to some kind of orderly definition of the sort of visual phenomena that you're painting. And the last comment, which is perhaps a bit more of a theoretical comment, but it's very, very striking. There's this German writer, Walter Benjamin, and he talks about the concept of the aura in painting. And he thinks that with mechanical reproduction, like with photography, the aura disappears. And what the aura is, basically, is the experience when we stand in front of a painting, not of a photograph, of the toil, of the hard labor that went into making this painting. So it's like you are returning back to the aura by beginning with a photograph and then ending up with a painting. That's super interesting to me.
Thank you for the question. The first point, and you asked me about the time. It's like I'm speech here. I don't have clock. I cannot control the time. Only it's here, and sometimes I help myself with this other art scene and take part in the show with me. I know around the time. And this is in my mind in this time, and I don't know, come this clock to my mind in this moment, and I must do all the painting in this deadline. And the other question, well, I try to go out from photography, as I say before in Spanish, I try to give my soul in the interpretation from this original photo. They are a progress before to paint. I use computer to change many things. I mean, I play sometimes with a psychologic portrait. For me, it's really intense when the portrait, the person in the painting is looking at you directly. That is something strong. This is for me communication. This is the moment, and you can play with the public to have this strong communication when the person, and in this case, a portrait, is looking at you. They are progress, digital progress. Before I found, you know, is when I paint somebody, is they are famous. It's easy to find pictures on the internet with this kind of personage, celebrities. But when I need to change the face, because I consider that I will have more power when the person and the celebrity is looking at you. I must play digital with this kind of position. Not only the eye, it's everything around the eye. This is difficult, but also I try. You know, I hope that I can answer you. I try also to put my soul in this interpretation from the photo, and painting in the end. I am a painter. I don't use photo and paint over the photo. I don't do collage. I am working directly with this technique when I am painting, speed painting. In another case is when I am in my atelier, in my studio, and I'm working there. I have another technique to work. It's the same technique, but no, with a deadline, and I must finish in this moment, because I must run to finish this painting, portrait, landscape, whatever. This is the case. The last area, black area, was some pictures in the end. Black area have this character. Okay, this tema is a tema inspiration to me, for me, from the Renaissance, the Baroque. For this reason, I come back in this time when it's so figurative,
and I play with the chiaroscuro, this black and white background. I try to be near to Caravaggio, Rivera, this style, so figurative in this time, in the centuries. But normally I am expressive, I don't have, I am really, how do you call it, dirty. When I am painting, I am really dirty, catastrophe, chaos. I am really chaotic when I am painting.
Exactly.
In the end, well, also it's because the we are seeing painting photos from the painting. But when you see the painting in a format, the format is like a door. You see life a short distance. You can see the well. Here is this two language together. You can play with the distance. This is of course you know. You can play with the distance. In the end, you have figurative portrait. But when you go so near to the painting, you can. For this reason, I use this second video in the beginning with this portrait from Gustav Kling. Was a chaos. You have seen the surface from the painting was a chaos. In the end, come a figurative order. Order is really figurative. No? So.
Hello, my name is Daniele, and I'm from Italy. Actually, first, congratulations. You do a very
Thank
good
you
job.
Very, much.
Very, very nice. Very interesting. And I, during your speech, I kept a couple of keywords which I found pretty interesting. We're talking about people that you said tienen miedo because they think that maybe they are not good enough.
Yeah.
And in somehow, that's kind of mission of the artist, you know, the society of the artists from Confucius and so on, which usually they link the society to something above, something, let's say, more spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
My question is, have you ever tried or thought to teach your art, or at least within your mission, to people that maybe they disadvantaged people? Like handicap or blind and so on?
Yeah. Thank you for the question. Yeah, I have this experience also. I work with autistic people. I have done, I don't use this video here, but in my website you can see the videos. I did project with people with handicap also. For me it was really a surprise because this is personal to say, but I don't understand autism like enfermedad, sickness. I don't understand like sickness, autism. It's, even more, I can say that an artist is like an autist because half his world, and when you are in your world, you don't want communication with society, with nobody. Was a surprise to me to see how talented was this kind of children was different teenagers also. And I did it also with this kind of people. I done also with academic, catedratic in art, fine art, people that know a lot of like I nothing, I don't know, only my experience. And I cannot speak about details about art historian because okay, I know something, but I am not academic. And I have also this experience with conference or workshops, and I have this kind of student or people that took part, and also person that don't have experience. Never before was painting people in my age, adults, and this is what age? Young adults, 30 age, tercera. People really old, 80 years also. I have students in Spain. And it was really interesting working with children with 7 years only in a politic like this. This integration, this communication between different age, different culture, different. This is really nice, really beautiful when you are working with this kind of people. And about this fear to learn something or say, I will try to do figure painting. There are people and is afraid. No, I cannot. I cannot try. I don't know. This is. I can use, for example, when the people in an exhibition told me, I don't understand about art, but I like your art. And I say, I don't understand about art. I like or don't like. This is like the beer. You can, in the beginning, when you try it first time, beer, you know, it's sweet, or you like or don't like. The art is a communication, it's a subjective language. And when they are this communication, it's enough. You don't need nothing else, like or don't like. Art is also, will be strong when it's something really hard, but anyway, it's creative. You don't like, in the end, you don't like this, okay, but it's a feeling. There are a message. You speak before about message, about communication. Exactly, that happened. Well.
Hello, my name is Marina. I'm Croatian, I live in France. I was wondering if you also work in Spain, and especially in Andalusia, and how do people react there on your art, especially on the fact that you're using traditional music in your art? And also the other question is, how important it is to you to be recognized as an artist?
Excuse me, the last part.
How important to you it is to be recognized as an artist?
Mm-hmm. Well, this is great. This is the wish from all the artists. Want not the person, but the art. When you have a language, and somebody can say, "This is that man, that woman. This is your art. I can recognize. This is the best because you are satisfied. You have a language. In the end, you did a language." The first part you asked me about.
If you are working also in Spain, and how do people react?
I have done 2 years ago. I have my permanent atelier with a lot of students in different age. The surprise is with this kind of exercise is always the people like, because I don't say nothing will they happen in the end. I only speak about abstraction, about tone, form, about write, read, but I don't speak about you will paint a figure, a portrait, a big portrait you will do in 1 hour, 2 hours. This is a surprise. This is a surprise for the people. And about the music, you asked me all.
If you work in Andalusia, if you maybe think that there's less opportunities there for artists, and how do people react on using flamenco in your art?
Andalusia is, there are a lot of creative people there. It's not because I am. Well, really, I was born in Barcelona. I grew up in Andalusia, in Huelva. They are special life there. A lot of hours, the line is not like here's really darkness. This is something that is a big influence in the people. I don't know why, but it's something. The atmosphere, the weather is something interesting, and an artist is influenced. The music, flamenco, when it's in at home, it's flamenco at home. We enjoy, but it's something like normal every day you have. Here is a little bit more. How do you call it? More. Exotic, exactly, this is the word, exotic. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nadia, I'm from Bulgaria, I'm an artist as well, and I wanted to ask you, are you able to make a living from selling art and teaching kids, or and how do you combine the ideological part of work and what you want to give with what with the way you receive to make your life better?
You mean about my art or about my workshops?
Yes, I mean, okay, maybe I wasn't very clear, but how are you able to live off of your art, or do you have to also do other things, for example?
I try to survive like an artist.
We all try to, but
that's
good. If you manage in Berlin.
Good question. I try to survive. It's not easy. It's not easy. You have two possibilities. And I learned this one in myself, like an artist, after a lot of years, not so much, I think. You have two possibilities. You can have the freedom, or you can have no freedom and make paint something that you know the people will buy. It's difficult to have the freedom, this creativity, and have the change to sell your work. This is really difficult. For this reason, sometimes I must make combination with another art. It's the case from like teach in Spain or here now in Germany with the workshops to survive. An artist is like this, you know. There are a time then when it's really successful exhibition and you can enjoy with all the sale, then you save full everything, or you can wait. And this is something that it's not like a normal job for many reasons. You are maybe working more, even more than a normal job. You have your time to work, 8 hours, 40 hours in a week. With a contract, with a, but an artist maybe is working every moment, or maybe in holidays, the people have holidays, or Sundays, weekends, and that means you are alone in your studio, in your atelier, and you don't know how many hours you are working, and you know that in the end you don't want to receive money for this reason. This is something inherent in the human being and in the artist. No? Thank you.
I don't have a question, but more of a comment, and I think it's going to echo the sentiment in the room right now. I think it's commendable that you can follow your passion like that, because not many people have the courage to do that. And you're resorting on your creativity to lead a life full of freedom, and you're giving that energy to people around you, and I think that's great. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't hear so good with the window. Yeah, okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Well, some more questions? Thank you very much to everybody.